very fun.
The teachers are always so nice. I always find it so easy to go in. Like ask them questions.
Every chance we get is practical. We're out here doing all different methods. And soon we're going to be going on to the more advanced technology that
Hello everyone and welcome to our virtual open event. It's Katie and Sam here, your Blackpool and the Fylde College School Liaison Officers. And what a show we've got for you tonight, guys. We've got some students lined up to speak to you. We've got an amazing list of our expert tutors as well from B&FC, from all different curriculum areas to come on and speak to you as well. We even have some live demos coming directly from B&FC, from our campus and from our high-tech facilities and our high-tech equipment. So much to look forward to. So thank you so much for joining us tonight. We have loads of other events coming up as well. So Sam, head over to you and just let them know what to look forward to in the coming months.
Yeah, so what we'd encourage everyone to do is get onto our website, blackpool.ac.uk. You can check out our events page, and on there you'll see that we have quite a lot of events coming up, including on the 28th of April. We have a specific parents' evening. So any parents out there who are watching tonight, if you want to get the inside scoop from some of our senior education team, some of our senior tutors, people responsible for the development of education for your children here at Blackpool and the Fylde College, we'll be having some conversations with them, also talking to student support and well-being. So again, a lot of holistic talk on that particular live stream virtual open event we'll be doing. That's the 28th of April. If you pop along to our events page, you can sign up. You can then get information sent to you, your preference, whether that be by phone, by email. We will send you notifications of when those events are taking place and anything else that will come up. We're also planning, for those of you interested in the new government qualification T levels, of which Blackpool and the Fylde College offers an array of different options for this new, what we'd like to say is a practical technical qualifications to sit alongside the academic A levels, then we are doing a live stream event for that coming up after the Easter holiday. So again, check out our events page. You can also look to sign up to our social media accounts. So we have lots of social media. We've got Facebook, we've got YouTube, where a lot of our videos go on our YouTube channel. We've got Instagram across college. Most departments have their own Instagrams. We've even now got TikTok for the college. So if you're a TikToker, we've got some wonderful creative material up on there. We're looking to add more there as well. So there's always great information on our social media channels. Also on our website, what's really key is putting in an application at this stage of the year. Some of you may have already done that, and you're just here to have a look at the different curriculum areas that we'll be talking to and some of our wonderful facilities. If you haven't put in an application yet, make sure you get it in by the 30th of April. That way you'll be in with the opportunity of winning one of an array of £50 Amazon vouchers. And obviously you can use that to spend on what you want, but you have to have signed up and put in an application to college by the 30th of April. We have, as Katie said, tonight got lots of different opportunities for you to get involved with us through our different demonstrations. If you have any questions or queries, then you can pop them in the comments. We have people monitoring the comments across Facebook and YouTube. We may get the opportunity to answer some of those comments that you put down live, but if not, our advisors will be able to respond to you. And that includes after our live stream. We're on the air for about 2 hours, finishing around 6 o'clock. If you do want to pop any comments there on social media, someone will always be monitoring it and be able to respond. We also have the live chat facility on our website as well. There are advisors in college now who are happy to help answer any queries or questions that you have, or they can direct you to the people that will be able to answer your questions. And we know that our tutors here at College Katie are really supportive, and hopefully that's what people are going to find out tonight, how supportive our college is for students.
Absolutely. In terms of as well, we also have some students, like I mentioned before, coming on, so you can hear directly from them how they experience B&FC, what they enjoy about learning with us, what they enjoy studying, what's about what they do on the different courses. So if there's any prospective students out there that do have an interest in construction or society, health and childhood, computing, those are just a few of our kind of curriculum areas that we're going to speak to today. So please stay tuned and stay tuned in to listen to us. Go on our social media channels, give us a like, give us a follow, but all the action is happening just here for you guys tonight.
What you'll find as well, Katie, if anyone is tuned into us live, is that we have an array of content on our virtual open event page. You will find that also on our YouTube channel. All of our videos go up on YouTube, and recently we've uploaded what we've called the World at Your Feet webinar series. So some people may over the past year have been a bit concerned, a bit anxious, obviously due to the pandemic, about what opportunities there are out there. But we at Blackpool and the Fylde College are one of the best placed educational institutions to help young people propel themselves forward, get out of this lockdown period, get out there into the world of work after their studies and get their dream career. And the World at Your Feet webinar series focuses with the different curriculum areas, delves deeper into their subject area and tells people on the sort of journey they can go on to and what careers they can attain. So that's really worth checking out tonight on our virtual open event page, but also on YouTube as well.
So should we kick off the show, Sam?
I think so, yeah. First up, we're going to be having a little bit of a look at our Construction Skills Centre with our Head of Construction, that's Carl, and some of his students as well. Hopefully, are going to be there to show you what they get up to on a daily basis.
So just recently, we stood in the Construction Skills Centre, and we've just had over half a million spent on the centre. So everything that we're working with is state-of-the-art, modern method of construction, latest industry specialist equipment with the latest health and safety equipment to support the learners, which they will then see in industry and hopefully make them more familiar. And when they go in industry, they'll find an easier transition from education into the workplace. The sector is struggling to recruit. We already know there's massive skills gaps and skills shortages. So coming in from school, the pathway is really to understand the construction industry, learn the skills, go into the industry, develop competency, and then move up into the professional sector where they'll be basically running sites, or there'll be quantity surveyors, or there'll be surveyors, or even architects of the future.
Hello, Carl.
Hello, everybody. All right?
Yeah, we're doing well. How are
Welcome
you?
Welcome to the world of construction, everybody.
There's our amazing...
Let's get in. We've only got 10 minutes, so it's only short.
So this is...
specific anybody wants to ask, be fast.
So this is our amazing Construction Skills Centre.
Sorry, Katie.
So you're going to show us now our amazing Construction Skills Centre, aren't you, Carl?
We are. So what we've walked into now is the trowel area, what we call trowel. With 10 minutes, we can't really run around the full building. So in this part of the building, what we have is brickwork and plastering. Within brickwork and plastering, we've just had over £500,000 worth of refurb. We've had over £250,000 worth of tool investment, and that's what we're going to take you through today. So is there any question specific that anybody wants to ask us while we walk around and show you around?
I think one of the key things that people want to know, Carl, because they've been out of, or we haven't had the opportunity for students to come in, is what are the facilities in terms of that investment you've had? What are they like for practical work? And obviously you've got students there in the background working with these tools. This is state-of-the-art equipment, correct? That it's the latest in the industry that students will work with.
So we're privileged at B&FC. We'll walk over and we'll look at a few now. We're privileged at B&FC to be the leaders of construction training within the Northwest and specific to Lancashire. What we're looking at now, if you look in now, we can see surveying equipment. So the latest surveying equipment. We've got a range of trowel tooling. So as you can see, we've got spirit levels, brand new trowels. We've got the latest in Festool technology. So this Festool technology is the latest industry equipment that's live in the market now. All brand new, all ready for use, guys. When you come to college eventually, to learn your skills on. What we've got in the background, because we can't run around the whole of the construction centre, construction offers a wide range of opportunities from brickwork, plastering, painting and decorating, electrical installation, plumbing, heating, gas, heating and ventilation, carpentry and joinery, bench joinery, manufacturing, machining. There is a wide scope for anybody wanting to come into the construction industry to learn new skills. The other thing that's really important is construction leads you to different places. So if you're thinking about university and you want to go up into higher levels of construction in construction management, if you come on one of our new T levels, so all T levels are live as of September 21, their two-year course, you get UCAS points that get you straight into university.
Brilliant. And what about sort of budding apprentices, Carl? Anyone who's thinking about doing an apprenticeship, what do we do as a college to assist apprentices that may be out on building sites or doing carpentry with a local company in terms of getting them skilled up with the knowledge that they need to maybe go on to have their own business in the future, to go off to university after the apprenticeship? How do we help those type of students?
So construction is a sector that values apprenticeships, and we're very good at apprenticeships at B&FC, and we're the leaders in Lancashire, if not the Northwest. So what we do, if you're not lucky enough to get an apprenticeship straight after leaving school, come to us, sign up on one of our full-time courses. So we've got the intro to a T level, which are all our level two programs and level three programs. Come into us, start developing and learning your skills. Employers come to us because we know the quality of candidate that we get out into the industry. We then pass students for interview, and then employers eventually take candidates on to be the next generation of construction worker. But if we've got any specifics, I've got Leon. Leon, do you want to come over, Leon? Alex, do you want to come over? So what we've got is two of our students now, live. I've got to put my mask on. Is there anything specific you want to ask Leon and Alex?
So what courses are you guys doing? Can you give us a bit of info about what you do on your course?
So level two bricklayers.
Fantastic. And is there a lot of practical element in that, guys?
At the minute, because of Corona and everything, we're in 2 days a week, Tuesdays and Thursdays. And then most of it is practical. And then we've got like theory and progress and stuff like that, just to check where we are.
So Alex, do you want to tell everybody why you're on the level two brickwork course? Don't get stage fright. Speak to the world, Alex. Come on. Everybody's waiting for you. So Alex is one of our young female students. So there's a big drive to get more females into construction. There is a lack of females within construction. So it's good to see young people like Alex entering the world at trade level, then hopefully progress onto HNC, which is level four qualifications, or maybe the level four site supervisor qualifications, and end up in some site manager capacity in the future.
So maybe, Carl, what does Alex think about being a female in a sort of male-dominated environment? How has she settled in? Has she felt welcomed? Is it a messy industry, or is she, you know, is she really sort of getting stuck in with all the men there?
Doing what you're doing?
Yeah, I really enjoy it. It's nice being around all the lads and stuff like that.
And you've also got some... Sorry, Carl, cut over there. You've also got some female tutors as well, haven't you, Alex? So do they support you on your course?
Yeah, a lot of them do, yeah.
Do you look at those as sort of role models?
Yeah.
So what I'd say to, if there's any parents watching, don't be afraid. Construction isn't a dirty industry. It's cleaned up its image. Everything is all about clean environmental sustainability. So just looking at a couple of the pieces of equipment, everything. So what we're looking at here now is the latest in extraction systems. When you look around the building, if you see the silver pipe going all around, it's fully extracted, so there's no particles, there's no silica particles. It's a clean, healthy, vibrant industry with loads and loads of opportunities to progress and do other things in the future.
So, Carl, is there anywhere that you would say, specifically thinking of parents here as well, again, like you've said, if they're looking in the industry, is there anywhere where you'd advise people externally outside of our own college where there's a wealth of information about the construction industry, about the skills gaps and why this industry is so vital for building back this country and why it's worthwhile for young people getting involved in it now?
So construction is the industry that's the backbone of the country, really. Construction never goes away. It's always regenerating, it's always rethinking, it's always redeveloping. It's a forward-thinking industry. what I would say to any parents, so B&FC is your first stop if you've got nowhere else to go and you want to ask questions. B&FC is your first stop. We'll always get back to you. For parents, young people, there's a website called Go Construct, and it's all one word, Go Construct. It's been designed for 14 to 19-year-olds that are wanting a career in the industry. Within the website, when you go on there, there are tons and tons of information, activities. There's a career builder, so it's a search engine, really. The more information you put in there, the more information you get back out. So do you like looking outside, inside, and then it pairs up sort of jobs within the construction industry. We've got to think that construction industry just isn't a tool or a manual job. There's a lot of digital within construction that people forget about. There's the CAD, there's BIM, there's all the offices type stuff, there's QSing, quantity surveying, surveying. So it's not just narrow construction trades. There are a wide range of sectors and jobs and job opportunities for everybody. But yeah, go and Go Construct, have a look around. Tons of stuff on there. Type in, there's a search engine as well for careers that brings up careers, what you need to get into construction. There's pathways where it leads you to higher level. A big thing for parents is university. We all know that a lot of parents, so what we talk, when you get in the key grades 4 and above, all right, a lot of people want to send the children to A level, which is an excellent choice, don't get me wrong. But like I said, we've got the career opportunities with the T level. T levels are the brand new course by government. It's a 2-year option. So when you leave, you've got, if you pass, you've got UCAS points. UCAS points get you into university. We've got construction companies now that want young people that are on the previous course to that. So people might know it as the BTEC in construction and built environment. The T level replaces it. But we have professional construction employers now asking for graduate, undergraduate type apprenticeships. So rather than go to, and this is a big thing for any parent, son's daughter's going to university, straight away there's a debt. I know it's a student loan, there's a debt there. If you come into our industry, people are paying you to take you on to do the degree courses, to go to universities and earn while you learn.
I think that's a major point that you've made there for the parents and something to take away from this. So why now? Why do you think now is the best time for people to get into construction, Carl?
Why now? Why not? Why never? You know, construction's never going away. It everything is re-evolving. I think the B&FC, it's exciting at B&FC at the moment. Like I said, we're the first to deliver the government's new T-level. So we've been chosen. We're the first provider in the Lancashire region. So if you're in and around Blackpool and Fylde Coast area, why not? Come to us. Like I said, we've just had over £1 million worth of investment in total. And that gets us right back to being a leading training industry specialist to deliver the next skills. We're moving into the new and emerging technologies, into the green. We've got all the gas, we've got all the heating, we've got all the electricity type stuff. The partners that are coming in involved, because we are a grade one college, we're a wave one tier provider. We've got all the investment in the new tooling. Why not? So earn while you learn. That's a big thing for me. The big thing in our industry is apprenticeship. We value that apprenticeship brand. It's meaningful, it's still there. Earn while you learn. You're getting your courses, you're getting your qualifications that will set you up for the rest of your life.
So Carl, we've just had a question come in from one of our viewers on Facebook talking about online courses for construction. Is there anywhere where they can find out information about this? I know we've spoken recently about there's a lot of work experiences out there at the moment for students to get involved in through speakers for schools experiences, city and guilds. Anything that is worth advising people to look for, sort of as a precursor to coming to college.
So what we've done, if you make contact, Sam, later, I've sent to yourselves a couple of online courses that are coming available now from awarding bodies, and that's trying to attract people into construction. I think going back to the previous question, we know that there's an aging workforce. We know that due to Brexit, there's a lot of people going back to the main homelands. So there are big voids, there are big skills gaps that we need to fill. And that we know that the contracts are there for the next 10 to 15 years and some big civil projects. The house building, unlike the issues that we had in 2007, where how the house builders sort of stopped overnight and construction really suffered, that's ongoing. So we need We need good people, good grades that can fall into construction, do the basic courses with us in college, and then we can get them onto the apprenticeships and move forward. In relation to online courses, it depends. I think we need to get a little bit more information of the need, and then we can advise and pathway. The majority of construction courses, trade-based, are physical, so you need to be actually learning the skill. A lot of the sort of the office-based or the in-type courses are high-level courses where you could look at some digital upskilling. So the digital, there's loads of free digital courses going. So that could then transfer over and transfer your skills into the construction industry.
Brilliant. No, I appreciate that. Well, Carl, we know that you've got a busy skills centre there. Lots of students active this afternoon in their learning. Thank you for sharing that with us. We'll let you get back to sort of moulding the minds of those young people, and we'll catch up soon.
Thanks, Carl. See ya.
See ya, everybody. Bye-bye.
So we hope you enjoyed that look into the Construction Skills Centre, everyone. So we're going to take a short break, and then we're going to be back and speak to one of our tutors from Blackpool School of Arts, and we're going to be discussing media. So if you're interested in film or TV production, then please stay tuned. Something ready for that for you guys to find out about.
you're entering into a professional standard environment. We are professionals and we expect professionalism from you. You know, with being a professional in that industry, it keeps my finger on the pulse of what's happening in the real world, and I can then bring those live experiences back to the classroom. One of the biggest selling skills in industry at the moment is a creative mind. If you look at any sort of job specification out there, they're all asking for creative approaches, because creativity is one of the most valuable skills that happens within the workplace. Don't try and dip your toes in it, just immerse yourself in it and get involved in that world, and I can guarantee you, you won't be disappointed. If your passion is at painting, do painting. If your passion is photography, do photography. If your passion is performance, be a performing artist. Go and do it, because if you are passionate about it, you will achieve amazing things.
Welcome back, everyone. Thank you for joining us again. So we're joined now by Mark Harris, one of our programme leaders in our Blackpool School of Arts campus for visual arts and media. So hi, Mark. I think we're just waiting for you to unmute yourself, Mark.
Hi, Katie. How are you?
We're great, thanks. How are you doing?
Not too bad, thank you. Just finished a session, so all geared up, ready for this.
So you are you on campus then, Mark, at Blackpool School of Arts?
Yeah, we are. We've been having students in and we've been very careful, obviously, how we're working at the moment. We've had students in and we've been trying to do practical sessions and learning using equipment, all getting ready to be producing media.
So you're one of our media and music teachers at Blackpool School of Arts, aren't you, Mark? So can you tell us a bit about how you got into that and what you did before you joined B&FC?
Okay, well, my background's mainly in media. So I've worked on various television shows and for companies doing small films and productions like that. So it's mainly been visual media. So I've worked for the likes of BBC, Ginger Media, looking at LWT as well, so London Weekend Television. So quite a lot of companies, because I used to live in London. So I worked down there for a lot of years. So I worked on television shows. I've worked on some live events as well. I've done some television advertising and I've had some dabbles in some films as well.
That's fantastic. So this will be a walk in the park for you then tonight, Mark.
Yeah, I want to see how you guys are going to do this.
Well, thanks again for joining us. And obviously, we've got our comments live, everyone. So if you want to post a comment directly to Mark, then please do so. But Mark, tell us a bit about the media course then at Blackpool School of Arts.
Well, the journey into our media course, it can start from leaving school. So we do our further education courses, quite popular with school leavers. And one of the big questions I ask students that want to come and do media, I'll go, what do you watch? What do you like? And it might be some of the guys are really into YouTube, social media. They might be really into like Netflix, on demand. We got some people that are really liking podcasts and some are really liking radio. So there's a big mix of what students can do on the course and why they come to us. We get a lot of students that are really curious about how films are made. They watch for behind the scenes and they want to know maybe how to edit and put things together. Or maybe they've got great ideas for stories and characters and they're like, I've got this great story and it'd be great if it could be done as a film and I want to show it that way. We've had people really crazy about wanting to produce music videos as well. So that's something we cover on the course as well. So, and we maybe direct them students onwards afterwards to go in specifically study in them areas. So we offer a diverse range. Media's massive, from screen-based media, and it's not just television and cinema anymore, because we're talking about mobile phones, we're talking about Insta, you know, all that TikTok stuff that's going on. So it all has to be produced, all has to be recorded, it has to be edited. We've got to come up with the ideas as well. And if these guys are watching this, it should hopefully be turning some cogs and making them want to be creative and go, I can do that, or I can do it better, I can do it different. So I get lots of weird questions about how to do things. And I'm like, okay. And sometimes I'm like, no trouble, dead easy. And other times I'm like, okay, let's figure it out.
I bet Emily, Mark, our social media officer, would love to meet some of your students and get them involved in our new TikTok channel that we have at college, just to get some creativity up there. It would be brilliant. But I wanted to ask you what you're saying there. You get asked that question. Well, you asked the question of students, you know, what they're into. Over the past year, obviously, in the performing arts world particularly, you know, cinemas have been closed, theatres have been closed. There was a period of shutdown in production of a lot of television shows and movies being pushed back and delayed. Yeah. There's still been an amazing amount of content that the likes of Netflix, Apple TV, Disney Plus have put out there. If you were talking, you know, with prospective students and parents watching tonight, and they may be sat here thinking, you know, I am a creative. Where can I get inspiration from? What have you seen in the last year that you would say stands out to you as really quality production? I mean, personally, in my life, I think watching the latest season of The Mandalorian, the Star Wars television series on Disney Plus, which used Industrial Light and Magic stagecraft technology, was so impressive, being able to recreate, you know, within a studio, these amazing panoramic scenes and giving the impression they were live, you know, in Africa or in Asia or wherever they were pretending they were being, or in terms of using their setting. Is there anything that you would say, go back and watch that, and that will inspire you if you're creative and you want to be in this world and go into a career here?
Well, I tried to create like a bit of a bucket list of films which I think some of the students should watch, and some of them are going to be real classic things. So like, I wanted to go back and watch some Orson Welles films, and I'm like, who's Orson Welles? I'm like, well, this is the guy that's doing stuff that people are still trying to do now, and like, he's ancient. And I'm like, who? I'm like, go and check him out, you know. So yeah, some of the stuff drives back to being really, you know, fundamentals and key things which even today we're like, wow, that's amazing. I'm like, oh, it's been done before 50 years ago by this guy. We're like, who, you know? So I suppose it's opening your eyes to that. Mandalorian's been brilliant for use of technology, and it's actually used a lot of technology from game engines, 3D game engines, to create them virtual sets. And they've done it, I don't know, I suppose in the long run it'll save them money, but you don't need a massive green screen stage, and you don't need to travel to some desert locations anymore. You can literally, in a nice little warm environment with a little coffee cup to one side, and do your acting, which is amazing. So for any students that are really into the technology and looking at that, it's like, wow, that's groundbreaking. But we've even looked at playing with that on a small level with, we've got a large plasma screen. Let's put something on that screen and let's film a product in front of it. And maybe we could trick people into believing that they're in that environment. So it's weird how you can sort of play with things like that. But yeah, production has continued. They've been really strict in how they've managed to manage this production on sets and television studios. And the film people at distances apart, but then they've edited them so it makes it look like put together, and you wouldn't know any different. So that stuff is very clever, and technology is helping that to happen. There's definitely been a shift to high-end television production, where before television production was like drama and soaps and TV shows. But the likes of Netflix now and Amazon, they're putting money into productions. Like, look at like HBO and Game of Thrones. Look at some of the big productions which have been on Netflix, and how they're continuing to be commissioned for seasons going forward. Even traditional things like The Crown, which is like amazing, and it might not be everybody's kettle of fish, but then you get things like Mandalorian. We look at the Disney Channel producing all their own stuff from the cinematic universe. So there's something there for everybody, and it's using film skills, but it's using them for a television production. So it's lifted television production to the level of film. And then platforms are also constantly looking to buy productions made by smaller companies. So you might be a small independent company or a filmmaker, and that after short form content, so it could be a one-off short film, it could be a small series of just 3 or 4 episodes, and sometimes it can be produced by individuals or small units of people working together to produce this to sell. And that is their product. So I think
as well, it's a big thing that I've noticed. I'm not sure if it's something that you've noticed. Documentary making has just exploded in terms of the levels. And I'm not just talking about documentaries in terms of what we see on TV, but, and obviously movies, but podcasts, and the way podcasts now are almost documentary series. A few years ago, I listened to Serial, which was a huge podcast. And these podcasts are actually having an effect in everyday life, bringing stories that happened 10, 15 years ago and sort of bringing public imagination into the fold. You think of things as well, like Netflix with Making a Murderer, and so many things that then just really pull people in. And that all happens with you guys. It can start with you at Blackpool School of Arts in media.
Yeah, we actually cover documentary as one of our units. So we get our students to do some research. So we have to know about a subject before we can film or tell a story about it. And we look at doing interviews. We look at finding facts and information. We look at legal and ethical issues to do with documentary, because you can't just say it. It's not quite like YouTube and vlogging. But I've got to say, one of the things which has made documentary more popular lately is the use of social media and individual voices and opinions. And if we took something which might be a vlog and we just pushed that subject up and then just increased the scale of it, it starts to turn into a small documentary. And sometimes the personalities which present in documentaries, like Louis Theroux, is very much, he's got his own style of documentary and he sort of features quite strongly in it. But not everybody's like that. Some people want to be behind the camera. They want to tell the story in a really creative way and present the information and the facts. And it's a big return on investment, is documentary, but very cheap to make, and they can have a very powerful impact, and it can appeal to a wide audience. So yes, they are constantly looking for events, current social issues, maybe things from the past, and bringing them to the front and creating programs about them.
Can you give us some examples, Mark, of the types of media that our students produce? Maybe something that they've done. I know you've mentioned some students look at going into doing music videos. Have you got any examples of what our students have produced and where we can actually see some of our students' work?
Great. Well, we actually have a channel which is used by media, and it's called BSOA Live, and it's on YouTube. And if you go on there, you'll find some examples of the type of stuff our guys do. We usually start with smaller productions. So we might start with like 30-second adverts. And sometimes we come up with some really creative, comical ones. Other times it could be, we had one not long ago, and it's for an Iron Brew product. And it started looking like a Hitchcock movie where someone's going to be murdered in the shower, like Psycho. And we pulled out the shower curtain to see someone there drinking a can of Iron Brew. So we get some really crazy things like that. We get some really artistic things where people have played with lighting and done adverts for Beats headphones. So we go from television adverts. We've done podcasting and radio news package interviews. We've done music videos, and there's quite a few music video examples on our channel as well. There's some short documentaries on there the students have made, short horror film dramas as well. So over the course of the year, they get a chance to try different types and different styles of media. So you can't just do one thing. You need to be able to do a little bit of everything. And on the channel, you'll see some really prime examples of some good examples of work. But at the same time, we put some up there which represent the more traditional and acceptable standard of work as well. So everyone starts somewhere, and we've had some students that have gone on to, you know, go into higher education and be, you know, auteurs or specific professionals at that particular area of media.
That's fantastic. That's such a great overview of media at Blackpool School of Arts, Mark. And we thank you so much for joining us. And we hope that the creatives out there are, you know, tuning in, they're going on Netflix, going on Disney Plus, they're learning all about it. And obviously our website is an amazing place to come and read all about our media course as well. So thank you again for joining us, Mark.
Cheers, guys. Thank you. Bye.
Thanks, Mark. Thank bye. You. I think it's amazing. You and I talk about it a lot, Katie. You know, we've been for the last, you know, few months, both on Friday tuning into Disney Plus as WandaVision's been on. We've both now started The Falcon and Winter Soldier, you know, with our respective partners at home. And, you know, you just imagine they had to delay those productions because of COVID, but they managed to create an environment where they could eventually film them, put that media out there. It's kept people going through the pandemic. And I think, as sort of an additional element of media, Mark, we didn't have time with Mark there to touch on it, but how media and these productions, whether they be podcasts, music videos, vlogs on YouTube or TikToks, have played into, you know, the positive mental health, or helping, you know, sort of keep people out of, you know, this huge mental health crisis that's being talked about as having occurred due to COVID. And I think it's just amazing how powerful and impactful creative people can be with inspiring the nation and getting them out of sort of negative funks and into a positive frame of mind, it is really amazing. And our students can do that right here on the Fylde coast at Blackpool School of Arts. It's just phenomenal.
It's great, isn't it? And like you mentioned there about the theatres and like anyone that's out there that's a performing artist, then we know that you're going through it and we know that you're missing going to theatres, watching your favourite shows. But we are here for you at Blackpool School of Arts. We've got a range of courses. That was just one of our courses at Blackpool School of Arts that you can choose to study with us. We have performing arts, we have photography, we have fashion, we have so much more to offer for you. So please go on our website and check those out if you want to find some more information out about those. But for now, I think we've got our next visitor lined up, have we, Sam?
Yeah, just before we head over to Caroline from Travel and Tourism, it's just worth mentioning again, Katie, as we do throughout these live streams, that we do have people, advisors on our live chat facility. If you do have any queries or questions, chat to them. They'll be able to put you in the right direction or point you in the right direction of information. You can fill in applications right now on our website, find your desired course. If you've been inspired by Mark there about any of our media options or, you know, earlier on, Carl, construction, anybody else we talked to tonight, go on our website, find your desired course. You can click on that apply button, fill in an application form, and then our trusty admissions team here at college will be in contact with you to set you on your way to your future career, courtesy of our tutors at Blackpool and the Fylde College. Again, queries or questions that you have whilst we're live here, pop them on the Facebook chat. We'll hopefully answer those. If not, again, we've got handy advisors who are ready to answer your comments. But yes, now hopefully we will be talking to Caroline, who's our program leader from Travel and Tourism. It's an industry that is very important to the local economy here in Blackpool. But also, of course, we all love going on holidays, traveling around the world. And many of us, once the lockdown is over and once travel starts to happen again, we'll be looking for that destination of choice that we want to go to. I don't know about you, Katie. Where are you thinking of heading off to?
Just anywhere with sun. Anywhere with sun. Just want to get out of this weather. Just get to that beach and get sunbathing.
You got that right here in Blackpool. It might be 30-odd degrees in the summertime. You don't need to go on holiday.
It might be. After last summer, we had a great summer. So where about you, Sam? Where would you go?
It's a tough one, really. I like going to America. My dad lives in America, so that's always a place of choice for me just because it's nice to go and see family. He has a swimming pool. It gets rather hot there, so that's quite nice. I have family in Australia. I do like to go to far-flung destinations, but hopefully Caroline can give us some insight too. And before we chat to her, let's give you a bit of an introduction into travel and tourism.
We do so much with the students. So I think tourism students come to us and they have an idea in their heads that they might want to be cabin crew, they might want to be holiday reps. There are hundreds of jobs that can take them around the world. Also, we look at local jobs as well and what's available to them on their doorstep, which is massive. We have travelled overseas, we've travelled all around the UK. We've been to places such as Portugal, Spain, Budapest, Germany. We have been on trips to London, experienced the world travel market. We've been up to Edinburgh. We go to theme parks. We've done Blackpool Pleasure Beach. We've done Alton Towers. Always out in industry. It's really important. It's also really important that they get to meet the employers out in industry in our local area as well. So they're experiencing tourism on their doorstep.
Hello, Caroline.
Right, hello.
Thank you for joining us.
No problem. I was just thinking, I was going to agree with Sam there when you were saying about the sunshine. It is a lovely day.
It is today, isn't it?
I should have been doing this outside, but I don't think my Wi-Fi would have handled it today. But
well, thank you so much for joining us to talk about travel and tourism with us at Blackpool and the Fylde College. So tell us a bit about the travel and tourism courses that we offer at college.
Okay, so I think the first thing I'd like to say about travel and tourism is it's just about introducing the students to a massive industry. I mean, this is just to the UK economy alone, it's something like 218 billion. And it's reassuring that there is still a place in that industry. There are still jobs going. And the courses that we put on are exciting. We are looking at new content all the time and trying to provide kind of a a stepping stone and an insight into the new jobs that are coming along. So if COVID's taught us anything, you know, it's adaptability, and travel and tourism certainly has done that. And we have to echo that in the courses we do. So a long way story of getting to it, but we are looking at our course provision as we speak. So myself, our curriculum manager, and the rest of the team, and we're looking at how we absolutely, you know, make sure we're up to date. We're looking at digital technologies. We're looking at the different destinations. We're looking at what's on our doorstep, like Sam said, you know. I will fill your feed with amazing things about our local tourism economy. So, you know, you could just sit back and let me go if you want, and I'll just fill the next 2 hours. But having that enthusiasm about our local tourism market and hospitality businesses, it is a vibrant, vibrant town. And it's just making sure that we showcase that to the students. So it's a bit of a sales pitch for them, really. You know, look what's on our doorstep. Yes, go and see the world, 100%. But it starts here. Absolutely.
Yeah, and I was looking the other day, Caroline, you mentioned there about how much the travel and tourism economy is to the UK. About 218 billion or so. To Blackpool alone in 2019, because obviously last year with the pandemic, most travel and tourism industry worldwide has taken a hit. The tourism industry to the economy of Blackpool was worth over £1 billion. Now, many people wouldn't even think that, you know, especially outside of this area. We know living here how important travel and tourism is, you know, how inspiring this place is for people, how much it holds, you know, the hearts and minds of people who've been traveling here for years and years, dating back, you know, to people whose families would have traveled here, you know, going back to the Victorian era. But the fact that it's, you know, I think after London, it's the second or third most important tourism economy in the country. There's no better place to be a travel and tourism student than right here.
100%. You're absolutely right. Yeah. And I think it's looking at where you can go from that. So I'm from industry, from hospitality and tourism. And if you can work in that sector, you can use those skills and turn your hand to kind of anything. So it's a fantastic foundation in terms of customer service, problem solving, being able to think on your feet, you know, and having the confidence to do that, travel and tourism. And you can take that around the world. So if you can get that base here in Blackpool, you know, you can go and work wherever, whether that's in America or the Maldives or China or wherever. You know, it just gives you that basic skill set. And Blackpool is just the best place to learn it, like you said. Absolutely.
Those skills as well, like you said, are so versatile and go to different careers. But there might be some students out there that don't even understand the range of careers that there is in travel and tourism. They might just think, I'm going to go and be cabin crew. Well, they might just think I'm going to be a travel agent. But there's so much more than that. So can you give us some examples of the wide things that students can actually go on to do?
Yeah.
As you say, the world is your oyster with travel and tourism.
Definitely. There's always going to be the place for those, for the cabin crew, for, you know, the people who go and work on cruise liners and holiday park entertainers. There's always going to be that, but there is so much more, like you said. It's similar in a sense to most strands of like business. So you've got marketing. Influencer marketing is massive in travel and tourism. We do marketing as part of the course, and yes, it's got the travel and tourism edge onto it. So, you know, we're saying to students, if you don't want to be cabin crew and you don't want to be a children's holiday rep and you really enjoy the creativity of marketing, you could go and work for TUI or Ryanair or a local travel company, you know, and develop their marketing for them. You could be an influencing marketer, you know, which is just a massive, massive area. And something we're still learning about. It's kind of ongoing. There's revenue development. Revenue is a massive part, and managing that revenue and those streams and where your money's coming from. So having that basis and coming and studying travel and tourism can take you in that direction. So it doesn't have to end there. You know, you could go into all sorts of different areas.
I think it's interesting as well, Caroline, because as you say, you came from industry. I also came from a travel and tourism background before I came to college. And if I think about where I started and the range of jobs I've done, I started off working in a child's soft play park. Now, people wouldn't necessarily associate that with a travel job, but when I come from a seaside town very similar to Blackpool. So when you've got inbound tourism coming in and they want to take their kids out for the day, well, they may take them to an indoor soft play centre. You think here in Blackpool, we have the Sandcastle, for example. People would work at the Sandcastle and not assume that they're working in a travel and tourism destination because it to them may just be a swimming complex. Well, people who visit the town will go there. I worked as a wine waiter and a standard waiter at race courses. When I was at university, I worked at Ascot Racecourse. So again, travel and tourism industry, again, people coming into the hospitality industry and doing sort of that style of work. Worked at Legoland, obviously big tourist attraction. I ended up on cruise ships. I've worked on cruise ships for the past 7 years. I was a tour guide at Chelsea Football Club within the stadium and the museum. You know, that in itself is so versatile. And I think that to me, as someone who's very passionate myself about the travel and tourism industry, is that it's not just about being a travel agent, which I think so many people, as and maybe parents as well, it may be a bit of a misconception. Travel and tourism, well, it's just being a travel agent. And it's really not. There's just such a variety of opportunities out there that, that gives you also global mobility.
I've been talking about that with some students this week, actually. One of my current students, she's looking to go into accountancy and she's on travel and tourism and she couldn't make that connection. So I've been talking to her about revenue management and, you know, these businesses still need accountants. The fact that you have got this travel and tourism behind you means you could just go into that sector, which is, let's face it, it's brilliant. You know, it's exciting, it's innovative, it's changing all the time. So having that basis to get you into the stream, if you like, that you want to go into, even like HR, so training development, massive part of travel and tourism because it's changing all the time. People are needing to be developed all the time. So we teach that. We do developing people in travel is the unit is called, and you put together a training plan and we look at motivation. So it's not something you'd necessarily associate with doing a travel and tourism course, but it's an important element of the industry.
I think what, again, thinking of, I'm sort of thinking here for our viewers tonight, which may also be parents as well as prospective students, and thinking back, you know, we're now a year, you know, since the first lockdown, and the travel industry, along with sort of catering industries, took a huge hit, a massive hit, and still suffering now. And I think a lot of people, and there may be some of this narrative within the media that, you know, oh my gosh, look, it's not a very secure career. You know, it's not a very good industry to be thinking about going into right now. Maybe you should focus on something else. Well, what we've seen, even in the past few days, I've seen a lot of cruise lines restarting, again, an industry close to my heart, relaunching UK only itineraries, which have flown off the shelf in terms of sales. We've had the airlines, people like EasyJet, you know, 200% in terms of sales, you know, thousands of people logging on after the roadmap out of lockdown was announced. What it shows is that bounce back ability and the flexibility and adaptability of this industry. So yes, whilst there are moments in time, and I can think of several, I can think of the volcano that erupted in Iceland and really impacted the airline industry, and going back 20 years now to 9/11, that really impacted the airline industry, but these industries have always bounced back. We are, as human beings, wanting to go and travel. We are wanting to have these tourism experiences, whether that be just here in Blackpool ourselves, wanting to go and visit the tower or, you know, to have the lakes. We want to do it, which means the ancillary industries of travel and tourism are going to have a massive bounce back. I think that message is key. And again, we're just in such a great place, as you've mentioned, adapting our own courses to meet this new demand for students who may be thinking, do you know what? I want a piece of that. I want to travel. I want to be involved in that industry that's adapting. I want to get those, even if I just want to get those skills to take me into a different industry. Yeah. You know, we are just so well positioned for that, aren't we?
Definitely. And it's for us and the rest of the teaching staff, it's about sharing that insight, the industry insight. So we're looking on Travel Weekly, you know, we're in the media and we're not just looking at the 9 o'clock news, you know, we're getting that information and saying, look, there is positivity out there. It's coming. Look at P&O doing the UK, you know, they've adapted. Ryanair have put on 26 new routes in the last few weeks. So it's coming. And it's going to continue to come because people want that escapism. They want to work in that industry. They want people want to travel. So they need people to, fulfill the jobs that are going to serve the people who want to travel. So, absolutely. There's no better time because by the time students join us in September and go through the course, the industry is going to be back in booming. Absolutely. Yeah. I have no doubt.
I think that's a great point you make there. Rather than short-term thinking of, okay, the industry right now is being on its knees, we're seeing that bounce back, to use that word again. Like you say, for 15, 16-year-old students who are going to be joining us in September, give it a couple of years, these industries are going to be absolutely flying again with bookings, you know. And I even think to myself, again, as someone like you who looks at the industry, and I think to myself, in a couple of years' time, the new Epic Universe in Orlando is opening up. It's Universal's new theme park. You've got Disney open or Universal opening a theme park in Moscow, in a new resort in Beijing. You've got new hotel resorts opening up all over the world. You've got new airlines, like you say, Ryanair, with new routes. The world will open up and the opportunities will be endless. To end on that, in terms of the world opening up, where's the first place you want to go to? Overseas, we know Blackpool, you'll be like us and you'll want to enjoy where we live, but if there's one place you want to go overseas when you can, where are you going and why?
I'd really like to go, and I've never been, I have to hold my hands up, I'd really like to go to Florida. I've got a young person in my household and he would really like to go to Florida as well. And we've been talking about it, I'd like to go before he doesn't want to go abroad with his mum anymore. But that's on our list for sure.
Nice.
Fantastic. Brilliant. Well, thank you so much for joining us today, Caroline. And we hope that we've inspired any viewers out there that are watching, any prospective students, to get on board, get signed up to our travel and tourism course, because the industry is going to bounce back. It's going to be booming and it's something so exciting to get involved in. So thank you again, Caroline.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Thanks, Caroline.
Thanks, Caroline. So yeah, Kate, I think that's right. Anyone who's interested, anyone who's been inspired by that, don't forget, you can go on our website, you can find your prospective course, you can apply today, don't leave
today.
It. Yeah, that's it. Katie's got the banner there. If you know that it's for you, why not apply? Don't put it off to tomorrow, don't put it off to next week, do it now. Start the ball rolling, have those conversations with college. And again, if you put your application in now, you're gonna be in it to win it. You're going to have a chance to win a £50 Amazon voucher. Deadline for submitting applications to be in with a chance to win, that's the 30th of April, but you don't want to wait that long. You want to do it now so you can go away next week, have your holiday, your Easter holidays, and relax knowing when you come back after Easter, you can get your place at college confirmed. You can have your interview, you can have your place confirmed, and you can relax going into the rest of the summertime.
Absolutely.
I think it's probably time, isn't it, Katie, for us to have a bit of a little break and give you guys a break at home as well to go off in that 5 minutes that we'll probably have and put your application in. You can relax into the next part of our live stream. We've got some really fun stuff coming up with some live demonstrations from some of our curriculum areas, including automotive and engineering. So we'll see you soon.
See you soon, everyone.
All the knowledge that we teach in the classroom, the underpinning knowledge, is backed up with practical sessions. We've got fuel injection testing equipment, and we get involved in the electronics and the diagnostics. We've also got engine testing equipment, where we look at the mapping and the performance aspect of the engines. So we get the students learning how to prepare the vehicle, inspect the vehicle, so we have no issues when we go to the circuits. And the students are actively invited to come along as part of the team. So it's hands-on in the pits in a live environment with other professional teams. And it gives them an insight into what goes on behind the scenes. And then they actually get closer to the action than we do as competitors. So it's really good, and it is really good to have on the CV.
Welcome back, everyone. Thank you for joining us. As we mentioned, we have something super exciting for you now, coming live from the ATC building at Bispham Campus, so our Advanced Technology Centre. We have our two members of staff. So hello, everyone.
Morning. How are we doing?
How are you both doing?
Yeah, as good as could be.
Fantastic. So I've heard you're going to do a little bit of a demo for us.
Can you hear both of us on this?
Yep.
Yeah, okie dokie. And answer any questions that you may have.
Yes, thank you for that, guys. We were struggling to hear you there. We heard little bits, but it was kind of cutting out. So if you want to just give us it again, but with a person with a mic, then we can hear a bit more about it. This is the technical difficulties.
Yeah, is it better now?
It is fantastic. Thank you so much.
It's probably because we're in a dyno cell, so it works on negative pressure. So it's quite hard to get technical stuff in here at the same time. So what I was saying is I'm actually with a level 3 group at the moment, but they're all quite camera shy. So they're all hiding in the background. But what they've been doing is a lot of work on this Honda Fireblade at the moment. So I'm going to carry out an acceleration run. To see what brake horsepower it's providing and torque, and then they can put that into their assignments.
Fantastic. It just shows the sort of high-tech equipment that we have on campus available to our students, doesn't it?
Yeah, definitely. Yes, it's above industry standard, really.
Fantastic.
Okay, so I'll pass you on to Danny again. I'll do the safety checks, and then do the power run for you guys.
Great, we're looking forward to it.
What we'll do is we'll put the microphone outside so no one gets any ear damage, because it's quite loud in here, that's all.
I'm sure it is. We're looking forward to it.
Thank you very much.
So if we just switch our headsets, what we're going to do is leave the room of where the motorcycle is with Matthew in there. Like we said, it gets quite loud. Got to turn the extraction fans on, obviously due to the emissions. So what Matthew's basically got currently doing at the moment is he's got to get the motorcycle strapped down and make sure it's nice and secure. This motorcycle will be reaching speeds of over 100 miles an hour, and even though it's stationary, we want to make sure that everything's nice and secure and safe whilst we try and get our power readings. Is that okay? Are we still there?
Yep, we're hearing you loud and clear, Dan.
Oh, brilliant. Sorry, I was a bit worried then because you
No, it's fine.
So little bits of what automotive are doing. Basically, we know that we're heavily going into the government's top 10 point plan for the green industries of the revolution. So with manufacturers racing to fully, go with driverless cars and electric cars, there's quite a big mad rush to try and make sure that we can keep up to standards, you know, moving away from the combustion engine and the environment pollution like that. So we're starting to see a big rise in movement with employment, so we can start new ventures. And with our outstanding facilities and obviously the tutors that we have on board, and the courses that we can deliver, we can hopefully put people in that direction of maybe even finishing with an honours degree and going to great places. Now, I'll just look at Matthew's just getting it ready for the first run. So what I'll do is, I'm not sure if you can quite hear it, with it being in a soundproof room. Hopefully he'll give us a thumbs up when he's ready.
So we can see the back wheel there of that motorbike spinning around at quite a rate now.
Yeah. So what we've got to do is basically the bike's got to be warmed up. We've previously done that. We're just going to go through all the gears, make sure we can select all the gears. We've got to make sure that the engine temperature is up to peak. Looking at Matthew, who's looking at us then, I think he's ready. And yeah, basically it's to make sure everything's smooth before we actually go throughout the whole rev range. Not sure if you can hear it revving in the room.
Yeah, we can hear those revs coming through.
Right, okie dokie. So Matt is happy to go on. There's a thumbs up. Okay. And hopefully with the noise that's coming through. So selecting each gear. And what we're going to do is going to pick up our final run in fifth gear. No point doing it in first gear. And this way it's best to find out what power we're going to be delivering or receiving from the actual motorcycle. So from near idle, we'll rev it right round. So on the graph that we will show you afterwards, we actually had a top speed of over 160 miles an hour then, where we was the RPM was in excess of 11 to 12,000
RPM. Wow.
So it doesn't look like much, but that's what a bike looks like at 160 miles an hour when it's strapped down. It's just going to do one more. I don't think he's happy with that. So back into first gear again, as you could see that big judder from the motorbike. Now, as you can see, that big cannon sticking out of the back of it, that's to capture all the emissions to make sure, obviously, it's breathable in there. So, again, we're selecting through all the gears, up to fifth gear. Make sure we're happy with where we're at. Then we'll go full throttle, 100% throttle. And this will help us learn our air-to-fuel ratio and other things that students can remap and play with to try and find peak performance. So currently just idling at 2000 RPM. Dropped up another gear. No, we're going to try again. Don't think we're happy with the gear selection.
So Dan, what type of careers would a sort of technique like this or a process like this be used in for students going on into the automotive industry?
So basically, we actually had a young chap who was with us last year, and he was actually part of the motorsport degree, the motorsport program. He was doing a level two, moving on to a level three program. And he actually works for a BSB motorcycle race team known as Yamaha McCanns. And he actually got that job last year from being at Blackpool and the Fylde College. So it can take you right up. Last year, up until COVID, like last academic year, he actually travelled quite a lot to different countries, and he was part of the pit crew. And yet, going back 18 months, he was a student at Blackpool and Fylde College. So it goes quite far, if that helps.
Yeah, that's brilliant. And if anyone's got any comments they want us to pose to Dan or Matt, then please do pop them on the live streams on Facebook or YouTube. We're more than happy to pose the questions there to the guys. In terms of the ATC, Dan, there's more than just this small room that obviously this bike is in, isn't there, for automotive and motorsport students? We've got a fully sort of functioning MOT center in effect on campus, and paint studios and everything, don't we?
Yes. So basically this room that I'm now back in, obviously we'll turn the extraction off, turn the motorbike off so you can hear me. This is a very small room, and this is where we have the motorcycle dyno. We found power, as we've just experienced. We have an engine test cell where we can put engines directly onto the same kind of equipment to find out peak power. We have a full-sized vehicle test cell, which you normally can see from the outside of the ATC, where we keep our formula event and we keep our rally mini. And then obviously opening up from there, we've then got our different workshops, from being commercial, being motorsport, or even just general vehicle maintenance and obviously vehicle body.
So you mentioned their vehicle body. We do have a different range of courses within automotive and motorsport, don't we? Can you go over a few of those for us? We've obviously got the paint side of things that people get into. We've got the motorsport. What else have we got available?
What I shall do there is I shall pass the book very generously over to Matthew.
Of course.
I see what he's done there. So can you repeat the question, sorry?
Of course, Matt. So it's just basically to go over the different types of courses that we have available in our automotive and motorsport curriculum area at B&FC.
Yeah, no problem. Automotive, obviously, like Danny said, it's huge. It's a bit, one of the biggest industries out there. So we cover general mechanical. So if you want to be a mechanic or work as a MOT tester, we do that on level 1, 2, and 3. Where you'll learn different skills from level 1 all the way up to level 3 to your diagnostic stuff. Is in motorsport, we've got a level 2 and a level 3 program, and they're all our pathway to HE. So by the end of your level 3, we can go on to a BEng honours degree in the chosen career you decide to do. With the paint side, I'm not really a paint guy, but I believe they do a level 2 and level 3 as well in paint, which again goes on to you can get a pathway to HE as well, I believe. Yeah,
fantastic, thank you for that overview. So
no problem.
We've obviously got amazing technology, amazing facilities there, and then also part of B&FC is our work placement. So what sort of work placements do our automotive students go on?
So they go on a placement that's around their area. So with the motorsport side, I usually get them out marshalling at events. We take the rally car out to live events where they're in the rough of it all, if you will. So they can meet all. Pardon? Yeah, we could actually move you around and show you around the workshop, if you will.
Absolutely, I think our viewers would love that.
Yeah, definitely, no problem. We can show you the rally mini that we take on the Northwest stages and other stages, the Hero stages at Alton Park. I'll take you around and try and make sure that I'm not tripping over anything at the same time.
It's fantastic. Our viewers are going to be loving this, seeing inside our amazing ATC.
Yeah. So I'll take you through to the testing dyno first. So this is an engine dyno. So as I've just shown you, it's a motorcycle dyno. So that's a fixed dyno where it runs off the wheel. This one runs off the actual engine. Yep.
Fantastic.
Trying to get the picture at the same time as well. So what we can do is we can build engines here. We can run them up nice and safe so we don't have to put it on the road. And we can change all different trumpet sizes for inlets so we can tune the car before we put the engine in. Okay. And the control room's there. It's a bit scruffy at the moment. But there's a control room.
It's okay. It shows you what a working environment is like, of course. And
definitely,
the amount of effort that goes into everything like this.
Yes. Yeah, so a lot of our students go on to work on with Jaguar Land Rover, and this is the kind of equipment they'll be using.
Wonderful. Would you be able to show us briefly the Rally Mini, as you said?
And then of course, we need to
wind it up with you,
definitely.
Matt. But it'd be great for them to see the cars and the vehicles that you've got there to show people that you will actually be working on live vehicles that have, you know, had a life on the road and that we here at Blackpool and Ford College bring in for students to work on.
Yeah, so these are the actual live vehicles that the students will work on and get their experience and their progression, and everything's made on these cars. If you can see, there's a Subaru in the corner there that they use for the dyno, for the car dyno. So we'll just walk through to the car dyno now, as you can see the Mini.
It's brilliant.
Okay, so we've got our Formula Renault, which was a championship winning car. This is what the HE team used really for data logging. So they set up all different types of suspension and performance, and they go to Donington Park and they check all their data's correct on the track. Okay, and then this is the Rally Mini. it's quite sad, really, because it was supposed to go out last year, but due to COVID, it couldn't. So,
well, we'll be hoping to get those students out on the road and on the tracks as soon as we can.
Definitely. They don't just go events as well. Under this lovely cover here is a level 2 car that they are actually building their own rally car at the moment. So from scratch, it's a shell, and they will be building their own rally car, and it will be actually entering the Northwest Stages when it opens next year.
Brilliant.
So there's lots of excited. I'll flick around now so you can see my lovely face. There we go. So yeah, there's loads of exciting things. It goes on and on. The automotive's huge. So
yeah,
there's no limits really.
Thank you so much for that tour, no Danny problem. And Matt. We really appreciate your time today. And I'm sure that prospective students have loved seeing into our ATC. I know that students are missing that. They're missing not being able to come and visit us at the moment. And we're trying to do everything we can with our virtual open event. So thank you so much for showing us around. That was amazing.
No problem. Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys.
Cheers.
See you later. Okay, should we move on to our next guest, Sam?
Yeah, so coming up next, Katie, we've got two guests from our Society Health and Childhood curriculum area. So this is for anyone who's interested in going into careers in education and childcare or health and social care. We've got Alisa and Lisa, who are going to be giving us a bit of an insight into their various courses and industries. But before we get to them, here's a little snapshot of what you can experience in Society Health and Childhood.
We're really fortunate at Blackpool and Fylde College. We've got our early years skills room, as you can see here. We've also got our early education suite as well. We've got our skills training room, which is like a mini hospital ward
where students can come and practice those skills of bed making using correct PPE. We work really closely with our local employers and we are working with them to be able to support the curriculum and plan the curriculum ready for what they need.
Hello, Lisa. Hello, Alisa.
Hi.
How are you both doing?
Oh, we're good, thank you. Them cars looked amazing.
They were great, weren't they?
Well, now it's your turn to show off your facilities, guys. You're both there at college at Bispham, in various rooms. We're going to start with you, Alisa. You're talking today to us about education and childcare. You're actually there in one of our primary teaching simulation suites, I believe. What happens here if you're a prospective student coming into college and you want to go into education and childcare?
This is our primary teaching suite. We've also got an early years suite. It's an opportunity for students to practice all the skills, develop skills that are necessary for the workplace. And we've got this is a teaching suite that's used for our pathway to teaching for our primary schools, secondary schools, and they can come in and use the equipment, have a go, get comfortable with using some of the different resources, ready for the workplace. We have skilled specialism teachers that will deliver the national curriculum, the EYFS. They'll do lots of planning, developing the skills, planning activities, ready to go straight into the work placement. Part of our program that we're so proud of is while students are with us for the 2 years and our T levels, we'll do over 750 hours in the workplace. So what our students love is to come in here, have a go, feel confident, ready for going out in that workplace.
It's getting that work feel, isn't it, Alisa? Being in that environment, being in that teaching classroom there. And obviously, Lisa, you're here to talk to us about the health side of things in SHAC. So you're obviously in our health suite as well, our health clinical suite. So can you tell us a bit about that and how often students are taught within there and what kind of equipment they can use?
Yeah, of course. So I mean, I am joined by my lovely mannequin behind. So actually I'm in our vocational practice room at the moment, but we're so excited because in September we're just currently building it, planning it with the architects. We're going to have our brand new clinical suite. Similar thing in our new clinical suite happens in here. It's where the students do all the practical stuff, and like I know this week they've been learning how to do personal care, so we've been doing the famous Shave Dave activity. They'll learn how to do things like bed making, take all of the physiological measurements like blood pressure, heart rate, So the again, similar to what they do in education, they learn all of the practical skills that they need ready for the workplace. I mean, we're so excited for September because we're building our technical clinical health suite. So we're getting all, we're getting fancier and fancier, where we've got some amazing industry standard equipment coming. We've got a this live big anatomy and dissection table coming, which is going to be incredible. We're going to have an even kind of bigger and better vocational practice suite, just because we believe that if students get confident with the practical skills they need in college, we know that once they go out into the workplace, they're kind of ready, they're up for it. So we're just so excited about our new suite in September.
So one of the big things, obviously, in our Society Health and Childhood area is the arrival in September just gone of T-levels. And we started off with T-level in education and childcare. It's been running now for just over 6 months or so. Alessa, how's that been going for the students that started in September? Are they enjoying it? Is it proving popular? Are we seeing that it's going to be the new way to go if you want to go into the industry?
Absolutely. They're absolutely loving it. They're really engaged. They've got a really rich curriculum, which gives them that balance of industry experience, getting ready for employment, those behaviours and skills that employers are looking for. The curriculum was designed with employers. It was, they told us what they were looking for, and we've embedded that into our curriculum. The students themselves are having a really good time. They just can't believe how much they've learned since September to now, and the grade profile is reflecting in that. They're doing, the information they're retaining, and I think that's because it is so practical. They're doing it as they're learning. They're applying those skills, and they've had lots of extra opportunities. Some of our students had the opportunity to meet Gavin Williamson, the Secretary of State. You've seen him on the telly. I mean, it's just those extra opportunities that they're having. And, it's just that really rich curriculum that's embedding all them employability skills and ready for university. So they're already on that learning journey, and they can see they've all got that end goal. They've all got the specialist pathways that they're undertaking. And they just, it's going really, really, really well. They're pleased, we're pleased.
Yeah, good. And I mean, you mentioned there that it can help students go on to university, which is fantastic. What careers can it lead to as well, T-levels? Because as you say, it's been designed by employers. So that's a key element of it. It means employers are saying to us as a college, we want your students to be ready, industry ready, to come straight from college into the workplace. So where can students go with an education and childcare T-level?
We've got a variety on that cohort. So some want to be primary teachers, secondary education teachers. So they're on their pathway to teaching specialism. So they'll spend 2 years with us and then go on to our BA Honours Education degree or go to another university to do the teacher training. And we've also got our students that want to go into early years practice. So at the end of the 2 years, they'll have the full level 3 qualification, the licence to practice, and can go straight into employment. We also have a few that are doing specialisms in play therapy, working with special educational needs, and a couple that want to go into like pastoral support roles within both primary and secondary. So it offers a broad range of different skills and different sectors, but probably the majority of our cohort this time, and I suppose it will vary from each cohort, what learners want to do, the desired career, but the majority want to go into teacher training. So again, really exciting.
And Lisa, from your side of things.
Of the future, sorry.
And Lisa, moving on to you in terms of health, obviously we've got a really exciting brand new health T-level that's coming in September. So can you tell us a bit about this?
Yeah, I mean, we are so excited for this coming September. So the T-level in health is aimed at students who want to become an adult nurse. So the only way I can kind of describe a T-level is if you imagine an apprenticeship and A-levels, and you combine those two things together. So there'll be apprenticeship in terms of the work placement in health and social care settings, so with the NHS, and then doing A-level, level 3 standard academic work. So it's just such a good course, because actually at the end, what the employers want and what the universities want is students who can do both. They can go out into the workplace and they can show and demonstrate that they've got the skills, but also they can write and they've got those academic skills that they need to become an adult nurse. So in September, the students who want to pursue that adult nursing, obviously with the entry requirements, that's where we'll be recommending for them the health T level. So we're really excited for September.
And can you tell us, Lisa, what the actual entry requirements are for the health T level, just so our viewers know?
Yeah, so currently we're looking at grades 5 in English and maths and science at least, just to give you the best chance of doing as well as you possibly can on this health T level. So I'd say from now until the end of the year, I'd say keep working really, really hard at all of your subjects and just keep going. It's worth it at the end if you keep working hard on all your GCSEs at the moment. It will pay off.
Absolutely. And you mentioned briefly there about the placement within obviously our Blackpool Teaching Hospital, so Blackpool Victoria Hospital, as part of our cadetship. So can you talk us through what that means? What is a cadetship? What does that mean for our students? And what will students experience while they're there working at Blackpool Teaching Hospital?
Yeah, no problem. So ultimately what a cadet means is that they're a student here at college, but they also are a part of the NHS. So our cadet students go out to Blackpool Teaching Hospitals and gain at least about 315 hours work experience. So what happens is we'll go through the cadet selection process and the students who are on the T level, and they get fully inducted into Blackpool Teaching Hospitals. So they get the same training as all the staff that go and work there. And they absolutely love it the day when they get the uniform, because they have a full cadet uniform and they look so smart. They absolutely love it. And then as they then start their placement, they will experience a range of clinical placements all around the hospital that relate to the adult nursing. So just thinking of some of the student placements like respiratory, cardiac, and some of the accident emergency wards, so that they do get a really good range of clinical work experience and they feel part of it because they're there. In the uniform, you feel like they're working alongside some of the staff at the NHS. So it's really good. Love it.
No, it's fantastic to hear. And obviously, throughout this last year, we've seen how important the NHS is to this country and the support they provide to people. And so, you know, for students to be able to actively train with the NHS, hopefully go on to have careers with the NHS, get that foot in the door straight away, is so valuable. Going back to you, Alessa, finally, Lisa touched on the entry requirements for T levels. Mm-hmm. And we've had a question come in through social about whether there's anything available to students if they don't get the entry requirements for the T levels. You know, how can they then get access to the higher levels of teaching? Is there anything that they can do, any courses that they could get on to maybe help them get onto a T level?
Absolutely. We've always got courses here at Society Health and Childhood. If you don't quite get your GCSE results that you want, it just means that you're coming in and maybe doing a pre-T, what we call our transition program year, where we focus very heavily on your maths and English alongside to make sure that you get those grades ready for the year after. We do run other qualifications, not just the T levels. But it's all about making sure that we get your maths and English where they need to be, so that you do get the opportunities to go on to university and to get those best jobs. So if you don't quite make it this time, we'll have a course for you. So don't worry too much. Like Lisa says, just really focus on these GCSEs these last couple of months, and all you can do is do your best. And if things don't go to plan, come and talk to us. We'll definitely have a program for you.
No, I think that's great and sound advice. You know, and we've been saying throughout this live stream, you know, if there's something that interests you, if you're inspired by what our tutors have had to say this evening, get on the website, find the course, click that apply button, put your application in, you know, and they'll be contacted by advisors, by tutors like you guys, to talk through the different options, to sort of give that encouragement to say, you know, if we can't get you onto that, maybe this is the right option. Maybe even open your mind to different courses and different strands and sort of find a new passion. So I think that's vital, as we keep saying to people, if you haven't put an application in, drop us one, easy as that, you know, fill it in online, and we'll have those early conversations and get the ball rolling for your journey to college. But, you know, we know that you guys have lots to do, you know, lots going on in the world of society, health and childhood. So we really appreciate the time you've given us this evening. Hopefully it's inspired some people to make applications or encourage those that already have put in their applications. And we look forward to welcoming them to college in September. But thank you for your time this evening.
Thank you both.
Thank you. Bye.
So, yeah, I mean, you know, it's again, Katie, one of those areas, isn't it, where we're seeing lots of people who want to go into either teaching or into health. I think it's shown again throughout this past year how important teaching is and how important our health services. These are valuable, highly skilled jobs. They are widely respected by society. You know, they're a vital component of this country. And also, again, they actually can be globally mobile jobs. You know, you can travel around the world as a teacher. You can travel around the world as a healthcare professional. You know, so it doesn't mean that you just have to stay in one place. You can really expand your horizons. And I think also what's key is that it shows that as we build back stronger as a nation, those job areas are going to be key to the success. Teachers inspiring the next generation coming through, and the health service continuing to nurture and look after the nation, keep it fit and healthy, and keep it functioning. So, you know, if you're interested, if you've seen something there that you like, check out the website, blackpool.ac.uk, find your courses in society, health and childhood, and put an application into us today. I think we're going to move on now, though, Katie, aren't we? And have a little bit of a video from you and me talking about why we think Blackpool and the Fylde College is a great place to come and study.
Absolutely. Here's our top 10 reasons, everyone, why you should come and join us at B&FC.
Considering your next move after school? Here are the top 10 reasons to choose Blackpool and the Fylde College.
We're in England's top 3% of colleges for student achievement. National Achievement Rate Tables data is used to compare performance between all general further education colleges in England. It's published by the Department for England, and in March 2020, it ranked Blackpool and the Fylde College the fifth highest achieving college in England.
We have a 100% pass rate across a lot of our subject areas. This is all due to the support we have available, as well as obviously some brilliant teaching facilities.
We're an Ofsted Grade 1 Outstanding College. In the most recent Ofsted report that we had, we were marked Grade 1 Outstanding. That's the highest you can get.
We're TEF Gold. TEF stands for Teaching Excellence Framework. This is a recognition of our brilliant teaching standards and facilities.
Guaranteed placements. All our courses include a guaranteed placement. This gives you the chance to go into the real working world, to try out those skills that you've been learning in a relevant work environment, and to get practical life experience as well.
Career-focused courses. All our courses are very work-based, job-centred and career-focused, so they really relate to what you will go on to do after you complete your studies with us.
High-tech facilities. We've got a few different campuses, and across those we've got some amazing facilities.
The FE Plus Award. This is an award that considers everything you do at college. The award is great for putting on job and university applications to show you have a lot more going for you on top of your qualifications.
There's so much support available for our students here at Blackpool and the Fylde College. Everyone is different, and it's important that you let us know about any support you may need, and we'll do everything in our power to get the right support for you.
All our students will hopefully love their time studying with us, but after that, we see them go on and be successful when they leave us. For a lot of our students, their next step is to progress onto our university centre and do a degree level course with us. We work closely with employers, and we work closely with you as an individual to help you be prepared for the real working world. It's all about helping you to be as successful as you possibly can be, which is obviously what we all aim to achieve in life.
It is important to remember, do your research, ask your questions, and make sure that you make the most informed decision that you can for you and for your future. We can't wait to see you at Blackpool and the Fylde College.
So moving on, we are now joined by some of our computing experts. We have James, one of our expert tutors from computing, and we have Sophie, one of our current students at B&FC, who is on one of our computing programs. So hello, guys.
Hi, guys. You right?
How are you both doing?
We're good, yeah. We've got our distance in place.
No problem. So before we get to you guys to have a chat, we're just going to give a little brief introduction video to computing and digital technologies at Blackpool and the Fylde College to hopefully inspire those watching this evening to put in an application. We'll come back to you in about a minute.
Realistic Club find everything they need to accomplish whatever we ask them to do. As of last year, we had a dramatic overhaul of our entire department, which means every room was remade, refitted with the newest computers. We've got a wide collection of virtual reality headsets, ranging from the Oculus Rift to the Quest, to the Quest 2, to the Oculus Go, to the HTC Vives. We've got about 20 different kinds of drones, whether they're flying, whether they're they drive on the ground. We've got weird tank drones that like bomb disposal robots that are fully programmable and buildable by our students. We've just spent £300,000 re-outfitting our development suites down at UC, all to make sure that the students have the best that they could possibly need to accomplish their goals.
So we're back with Sophie and James. Sophie, going to come to you first, if I may. You're actually, or have been, one of our students at Blackpool and the Fylde College, right?
I was, yeah. I did a degree in networking and cybersecurity.
Brilliant. So what did you like the most about the computing course and your degree here at the college? And what did you sort of learn on that?
Okay, so I think the thing I liked the most was the fact that all the equipment was so up to date, all the equipment, all the software we got to use was cutting edge. We weren't ever behind on anything in terms of software or hardware, and it didn't matter where what your background in the world was, everyone was welcome, everyone was able to contribute, and as the only female on the course, I felt so comfortable with everyone, it was amazing. And we learned very much about networking and cybersecurity in the real world.
Brilliant. So some students out there who are watching tonight might be thinking, you know, computing is all about sitting in a little cube booth and it, you know, it's very much just head in a computer sort of thing. And, you know, you've just sort of blown that out of the water there by, you know, saying it's so dynamic. And yourself as a female in a STEM area found it sort of quite dynamic and really supportive, which is amazing. Why should students, and maybe even from your angle, particularly girls, consider studying computing now or any time to do it?
Well, to be honest with you, at the moment there's never been more of a digital era than we just had, especially the pandemic and everyone moving online and virtual events like this. But there's loads of different areas you can go into computing. It's not just sitting at a desk coding in a very dark, cold room. When I graduated, I went and worked in cyber for a couple of years. I was doing all sorts of network analysis. You're doing things like going into buildings as part of your job, seeing all these different places, going around the world. And computing is one of those qualifications where if you want to work somewhere else around the world, it's pretty much guaranteed you can. And it's just so amazing to be able to work in all these different areas. You can teach, you can program, you can game design, you can turn whatever your hobby is at home.
I think that's brilliant. I like that as well. You know, it's something that can be a hobby for people that can become a career. And you mentioned there things like games development. So many people out there are gamers. Yeah, I'm a gamer myself. Not at a high level. I have a Nintendo Switch. I don't know if you can class that as gaming to a high level. I played a lot of Call of Duty when I was at university, kind of because you have the time. But it's one of those things that you can convert into a career. It's something that, you know, you play with your mates online at home, and you can be creative. You can design networks. You can design games. You know, there's even the sort of development now, wider field of esports. You know, and obviously it's not just computer games. It's games on mobile phones. It's app development. It's just such a huge industry. There's so much there. So, you know, good luck to you, you know, going into the industry when you complete your degree and you go on to do amazing things. I know, James, obviously you're one of our tutors. Katie wants to sort of ask you a few questions, but before she gets into that, what is it that you've got there on the desk in front of you there between you and Sophie? These drones, robots, what are they? Lego, what is it?
You're right the second time. So these are robotics. So we tend to use these in the extracurricular activities we offer. Obviously, when we are normal times, that's what we'll be looking at doing. And also through the courses we run within the community department, we also use these as well.
Fantastic. So can you program the robotics then? Is that something we do at B&FC as part of the course?
As one of the units within the course in computer science, you already can learn well to program things like these here using Python, so JavaScript. So you'll learn to do that once you actually progress through your courses here.
Fantastic. And what about the computer game side of stuff? Can you develop computer games as part of the course as well?
So part of software engineering as well as the course we have here, you can do app development. Obviously, we know through apps, we can create games, social media platforms. So possibilities in computer science in terms of design, programming, different games or apps is endless, really. And again, it's always progressing, always looking on to the next new thing. So we're always looking to keep up to date with everything.
Fantastic. So what other jobs can students get into from one of our computing courses at B&FC?
So there's quite a lot. A lot of main streams are through so software engineering, again, related to app development, system administration. So you're looking at cyber ethics and laws. Network strategies and topologies, and cyber security, which is a very popular one. Again, looking at ethics and laws, cryptography, and cyber security trends. Also, away from the programming side, it's looking at game development, you can become the game designers, data analysis. Also, with the pandemic and something that's positive that's come out of it, a lot of industries, a lot of businesses that are working online, remote working. So a lot of these businesses are looking for social media managers, again, which can be related to computing. We do a course with the foundation degree. We do a course where we look at social media and business and how you can monitor trends with that as well to establish your connection with consumer bases. So again, the jobs that we have through the computer department are pretty much endless and always growing.
And obviously we have the best equipment at B&FC for students to work on, the facilities that we have there. But obviously the students have a work placement as well, don't they? So what can they expect on the work placement?
Yeah, so our work placement initially is 20 hours a year. However, the students have the opportunity, and it's very rewarding. Or from some of our students, as they can do an 8-week work placement. And again, that falls in line with chosen course as well. So you get that form of work experience as well as learning how to do everything to the theory on the as well.
Fantastic. There's so much to offer for computing and digital technologies at B&FC, and I hope that those out there that enjoy computing, enjoy gaming, will consider some of our courses and maybe check out our website at blackpool.ac.uk, go onto our computing curriculum area and have a look at the courses and maybe click that apply button if it does interest you. So thank you so much for your time today, James and Sophie. We really appreciate it.
Absolutely.
Great. Thanks, guys. It's another one, Kay. I think we've been spoilt really this evening with all the curriculum areas we've talked to so far.
Definitely.
We've got one final one coming up, which we'll get to in a moment because it's really exciting end to the live stream. But the scope for computing is huge. Again, it's one of those things, you know, we're live now, you know, this is this network that we're across using StreamYard, streaming on YouTube, Facebook. Someone has designed the coding for that. Someone has designed how that functions. The mobile phones that we use to communicate, someone has designed that. You do that through a computing course. You can learn the skills, you can develop your abilities in that with us. And we have the facilities, as James and Sophie sort of touched on there, to be able to do that with people. It's absolutely stunning.
It really is. It was such a good insight. Even to see them there with all of our facilities that we have and the drones and different bits that we have, it's just great for our students to use that equipment that's in line with employers. So as you said, we've all got mobile phones, we've all got computers, we've all got laptops. And I'm sure over the lockdown period, a lot of us have been relying on those and using them a lot.
Yeah. And what we sort of talk about in terms of employability skills as well, you know, it's the connections that you'll get from being on any course, and it's not just computing, any course that we have at college. And a lot of our students always talk about that. They talk about how, you know, they're given access to practical elements that you maybe wouldn't get if you were to do A-levels, for example, because A-levels are really academic and you're in the classroom most of the time. We pride ourselves on having industry standard tutors, people who go back into industry. We've spoken to a few this evening, people like Mark, who worked in London, you know, for the BBC and others, Caroline, who's worked in the travel and tourism industry. It's amazing. And the amount of support they offer our students is unparalleled, really. It's just so amazing. But, you know, I don't want people to take our word for it. You know, we could sit here and say as much as we want about how amazing college is, and people may think, well, you know, of course you're going to say that. You guys are hosting this live stream, but maybe it's worthwhile, Katie, people hearing from our students and what they have to say in this wonderful view from the students.
Well, the tutors are always very open to questions. If anyone's struggling, then they always go above and beyond to try and help that student. And the course itself is very open, it's very fun.
The teachers are always so nice. I always find it so easy to go and like ask them questions.
Every chance we get is practical. We're out here doing all different methods, and soon we're going to be going on to the more advanced technology that the college supplies to us.
So I've had a lot of support in terms of being a woman in a STEM course. And lots and lots of encouragement as well.
I like how in-depth it is, and it teaches us the more professional side of stuff, and the tutors are great.
They're all from different backgrounds within the public services, so they know what they're talking about. But they're there to support you and, you know, get you through it and get you through this course and achieve what you want to.
It's just an amazing college. Like, I've heard all the reviews, and everyone that I've talked to that's come here has mentioned how supportive all the tutors are and how well they've progressed in their career.
Not many colleges offered facilities such as this, so it was perfect.
Well, last year I attended and I didn't really like the way that they teach, so this year I thought I'd try Blackpool and Fylde, and I'm really enjoying it and I'm doing well in my subject.
This environment was like the correct environment for me, because these staff are nice and friendly, and, you know, it's nice and near. Overall, it's just a perfect college for me, really. It's just, you know, it's just brilliant.
So I looked at a few other colleges, but they didn't offer the practical aspects, so that's definitely something I've enjoyed. And another thing that I really liked is the TEF gold standard that the college and university have. Just in general, a really high standard college.
Like I said, it was apparently meant to be a great, great college, and it is. I've achieved what I've wanted to achieve so far because of being here and the help and support that I get. A good environment to be around, and you feel welcomed and you make loads of friends. So, yeah, I'd definitely choose it.
I want to go into doing my degree at the end of college.
Join the police in Manchester.
Well, hopefully I want to take over my granddad's nightclub.
Hopefully you become a chef.
Yeah.
Software or game development.
I wanted to do architecture at university.
Being a sports scientist, definitely something that I'm looking to do as a career.
My big goal is to become a pilot with the RAF.
So as you can see there, some really impactful statements by our students, just really highlighting all the support they get at college. The standards of teaching, and just that they enjoy it. I think that's a key thing, isn't it, Katie? We can talk all the time about how amazing our facilities are, how amazing our teachers are, but we want people to have fun. We want people to feel welcomed. You know, when they need something, just ask, and people will be there to help them, because it can be anxious coming to college. You know, you've been at school for a while. You've been with all your friends. Your friends might be going somewhere different. You know, you've been with the same people in your class for 3, 4, 5 years, maybe even come up with them all the way from primary school. You've been with the same teachers in your high school for a few years and you're changing to this new environment. It's just so nice to hear that you'll feel welcome and part of a nice community environment, very friendly place at college. And we both can attest to that, even, you know, just working there. It is so friendly. It's so open and nice. I think that's just such a key selling point that can be overlooked sometimes.
Oh, 100%. The students are key. And obviously, like you mentioned there, we do want people to have fun when they come with us. We want you to enjoy your time with us. It's not all about the studying. Obviously, you've got that work placement as part of all of our courses at B&FC. You've obviously got our expert tutors that come from their industry fields to give you all of that industry experience. But we do have so much more to offer at college, things like our enrichment program, our SU, so our students' uni as well. So if you want to find out any more information about our range of clubs, societies, everything else that we've got going on in college, then please head to our website at blackpool.ac.uk and you can find all the information on there as well. But I think for now, we've got a massive showdown for you. We're going to join up now with Nicole Dean, one of our programme leaders for engineering. And first, we're just going to hand over to them and we're going to show you a little short video.
So everything that we have here is industry standard. So what they'd be using in the workplace, they're going to be using here. So we have things like we've got PLCs, we've got hydraulics, pneumatics, we've got the latest in the welding equipment, we have flow benches, wind tunnels for the aeronautical. We also have a nuclear simulator for our nuclear engineering as well. So they're working on what they actually would be working within the industry. So like I said, with BAE, we have a lot of British Aerospace students. We work with Westinghouse, Springfields, a lot of the local companies, smaller, so local manufacturers like Fox's Biscuits. We have a number of students that progress with us from level 2, level 3, all the way to the degree, gone on to work in places like Rolls-Royce, Boeing for the aerospace. So we have a lot of good industry links, also locally people like Blackpool Transport.
So we're back, everybody, and we see Nicole is with us. Hi, Nicole.
Hi, guys.
Thanks for finishing the show for us today. We know that you've got something really exciting for everyone who's watching, and obviously a chance for people to see again inside our Advanced Technology Centre the type of equipment that we have. But before we hand over to you, Nicole, Kate and I just want to say to everyone that's tuned in this evening, you know, thank you for coming along. Stay on for what Nicole and her team have got to show you, because I'm sure it will amaze you and really inspire you, especially if you're wanting to come and study engineering at college. Don't forget, check out our website for all of our upcoming open events. We have another event on the 28th of April that's specifically designed for parents. So any parents out there that want to learn a little bit about what college does for your child or your children who want to come to study with us, what support we offer, what well-being support there is, and also what the standards of education are. We'll have some senior members of staff to talk to you about that. We're also looking to do a specific T-level live stream as well after the Easter break. So get yourself signed up through our events page to all of our notifications. Sign up to our Facebook page, our YouTube channel, any social media, all the social media. If you've got it on your phone, we've probably got it. Sign up to it and you'll get all of those notifications.
And if you are watching on replay, everyone, and then please do leave us comments. We do have people checking this live stream and they will get back to you. And obviously on our website, if you want to chat directly with one of our friendly advisors, then just visit our website at blackpool.ac.uk and just click on the little live chat button at the bottom and someone will come straight to you with any of your queries. So like we mentioned before, the website is the hub of all of our information. So please head on there, check out our courses, check out the range of other things we've got going on at college, sign up to our event, get involved on our social media, and we hope to see you at our next virtual open event.
And don't forget, everybody, put in your application now. If you haven't done so already, get it out of the way before Easter. You can go and enjoy your Easter holidays. If you put it in before the 30th of April, you'll be in with the chance to win a £50 Amazon voucher. Who wouldn't want a £50 Amazon voucher, especially heading into the summer? Get something nice for coming out of lockdown. Whatever you want to spend that money on, then you can do. But you've got to be in it to win it, as they say. You have to put your application in, register on the website, fill in an application before the 30th of April. The application is so simple. Just find your desired course on our subject area pages. What you can find there is all the information on the course, a nice little apply button. Click that, fill the form in and submit it. Easy as that, and someone at college will be in touch with you to talk through the next steps. But that's enough from Katie and I for today. Once again, everyone, thank you so much. We'll be seeing you soon at our next live stream event. We're going to hand over to Nicole now and her team in engineering to round out the show.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, guys. So, hi, everybody. Thanks for staying with us, engineering right at the end. So for those of you that are school leavers, we do have a couple of options. Something that is quite new to us this year is our welding and fabrication. This is basically in response to the industry in general. We have such a high employability rate from our courses, but in particular, there's very, very high demand for welders and fabricators. So this is something that we've put on, and it's definitely something that's wanted in the industry at the moment. Our other level three course at the moment, you have several options. So we have mechanical engineering, aerospace, electrical, manufacturing, and general engineering. So again, two-year program. In your first year, you will do a little bit of general engineering, and in your second year, we have the ability to specialize. As part of all of these programs, you will be working in the Advanced Technology Center, which is where I stand right now. So what I'm going to do now is just give you a little bit of a tour of the equipment and all of the things that you will be using when you come to us. So let me turn around my camera. So you can probably hear a little bit of noise in the background now. We are in live working workshops, so we do have students on at the moment. So we are currently in our machining workshop, and as you can see, everything that we have in here is industry standard equipment. So everything that you would work on as part of your job after you leave us is what you train on with us here. So I'm just going to take you through, and apologies for the noise, but we do have a live class on at the moment. So if we can see in here, we have the welding workshop, and we've got students in the middle of a class here. They don't really want to be in the camera. So we have, again, fully functioning welding workshop in here, and again, industry standard, and this is so sought after at the moment. So we're just going to go through to our next workshop. And I'm going to bring you through now to our shop where we have another of our members of staff. This is Gavin, who is our program leader for engineering as well.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to one of our advanced engineering areas. My name's Gavin, and if you come on to our level three program, you'll see me a lot. I tend to get involved with the first years for the level three. So a quick whiz round of what we've got going on in here. So some of these sections that you'll deal with for advanced engineering is fluid power systems. So that's hydraulics and pneumatics. And these are all our hydraulics and pneumatic rigs that we'll be using. And I think one of the key things that you have to understand if you come to Blackpool Fylde College is that all the equipment that we use is industry standard equipment. So everything that you see here and use is, in fact, used in industry. So you'll be getting that industry feel for everything. So if we have a quick look, this is a bit of a new area because a lot of this machinery was put in other areas, and then we've just moved it all into this manufacturing, advanced manufacturing side of things. So the big red machines here are mills or MCO machines. So these are computer-driven millers. And you'll be learning up on these and doing everything. That's what we call CNC work. So there's a lot of work for CNC operators out in the industry. So we have two of the big milling machines there. And this is another CNC type machine, a DMU. But like I say, you will find that there is a lot of job opportunities for that in this area. And we have a CNC lathe. So you can see a lot of the buttons and things like that. So there's lots of material things these days are computerized. And in your course, you will be doing a lot of programming. Some mandatory units is about programming. So if you have if you're interested in programming, great. But it is worth starting to look at programming and microcontrollers and things like that, and just to get a basic understanding of programming. Because whether you're programming these or for many of you, you'll be programming the robot. And we'll just go inside there. Keep the door shut. So this is an industrial robot. And you'll be learning to program this certainly for the manufacturing, mechanical engineering, electrical engineering. They all come in and do part of their course on the robots. If you're aeronautical, you will be doing more theory of flight and things like that as opposed to the robots. So if you're interested in this sort of stuff and the ENCOs and all the manufacturing side, your pathway needs to be manufacturing stroke mechanical or electrical engineering. Yeah. So bear that in mind. If you're looking at this and you go, yeah, I want to get involved there. A lot of work available for robot programmers as well that travel the world and do everything. So yeah, so once again, this is an industrial robot that you can find. It's only a baby one, but it's a sort of industrial robot that you can find yourself working closely with, maintaining and operating. So that's what we do on there. I think Nicole's probably spoke to you about the length of the course, that it's a 2-year program, but split into two parts. So we do a diploma in the first year, and then in the second year, you decide your pathway as you go forward. So in your first year, you get a taster of everything, and then you can make that informed decision where you want to go to from there on in. So I think that there's probably just what, one more thing to say, Nicole?
Yes, there is, Gavin.
Okay.
So thank you so much for watching, everyone, and we will see you in September.
Thanks. See you soon. Bye now.